My name is Richard Keegan. I'm a sport and exercise psychologist working at the University of Canberra here in Australia. And I qualified and grew up as a psychologist in England, where I studied first at Bristol, then at Loughborough, and then spent some time working at the University of Lincoln. The areas that I'm working on include, first of all, the actual job of a sports psychologist, and I'm lucky to be able to write about that, think about that, and teach that. And so the decisions we make on a day-to-day basis regarding the types of questions we ask, the types of goals we're trying to achieve with each client, how we go about pursuing those goals, I think that's a really interesting topic, and it's something which I want to keep researching for a long time. My PhD was actually in motivation, and in particular the considerations of how the people around the athlete affect their motivation at different age levels. So in young kids, adolescents, and also the more elite players who've actually made it, and trying to understand how those complex social interactions might actually affect the person's motivation, because the chances are it's not a simple equation of this one thing will make them more motivated, even though that would be very convenient. More recently, I've been involved in some work around the idea of mental fatigue and how athletes who are not physically tired but may have had a hard day at work or may have been travelling or harassed by media, for example, how that can actually affect performance. And we're seeing more and more frequently that these athletes perceive that their effort is actually it's much harder to achieve the same level of performance, even though they're physically fine. Their perceptions of those same bodily signals are somehow much more unpleasant. So it's a very interesting area, just by being mentally fatigued, that we can see people being affected by that. And one final area I've published in a few times recently is this concept of flow in the zone, where people seem to be able to perform with effortless excellence, and it just clicks into place. And again, we've been finding that that's really interesting, of course, but also it varies depending on the sport that you might be playing. So it might look very different in the sport of golf as opposed to the sport of squash or tennis. And the type of flow and the subjective experience will be different. But overall, it's this idea that not only am I performing brilliantly, but I'm finding it effortless and I haven't got to exert mental effort to control what I'm doing, which I think is probably what we often want our athletes to achieve. So that's the type of thing a sports psychologist will be involved in. Of course, there is much more out there. I started studying psychology in the first place after a failed career as an airline pilot, where I just didn't have the eyesight to make it. So the question became, what else am I good at? And hopefully I've been proven right that I'm good at talking with people and solving problems. Now, I guess at its heart is what psychologists do, and I've been tempted into sports psychology because I like sport and I like the different question of how good do you want to be. It's something more positive for a day-to-day way of life. Suppose what I enjoy most about psychology is that it actually shines a light on a lot of behaviours that we see every day, and it gives a name and a framework to a lot of things that people do all the time. It just begins to allow us to get a grasp and a concept of why people behave as they do. On the other hand, of course, sometimes we're far too ready to overinterpret and to give people labels long before we know really if that's true or not. And I particularly remember during my undergraduate studies, every party I went to, somebody would say, "Say psychology. Okay, then what am I thinking?" And of course, we don't really study how to mind read and how to, pop thoughts necessarily into people's minds. And as that realization has crept upon me over the years, that we're not necessarily finding clean and simple rules that explain everything, there was a time where that was very uncomfortable and I wanted rules that were hard and fast, but actually there's something very rewarding about navigating uncertain territory and still finding your way through and still generating benefits. So that's become a positive for me. What did I least enjoy during my undergraduate studies? Statistics, I think. It's one of the only subjects that I very nearly failed at my first attempt. And I remember the lecturer's name to this day. And my reaction was to then go and make sure I was good at it. And so I'm reasonably good at statistics now. I also subsequently have learnt qualitative methods as well in as much depth as I can. And looking back, there's tremendous power and knowledge and insight available from understanding research methods and statistics. It allows you to see the true strength and the true meaning of studies' findings. So at the time, I think most of us would agree it's not a particularly pleasurable experience trying to work out what an eigenvector is or trying to understand whether P is significant or not. But looking back now, every week when a different newspaper reports that red wine cures cancer or causes cancer, or that some particular new product boosts performance by this much, I'm able to actually go and dig a bit deeper and see whether those findings are solid or robust. And that's, again, a good source of insight. It's quite enjoyable to be able to just fact check afterwards. My advice for students just starting to study psychology would be early on to try and abandon the notion of certainty and finding concrete answers. We can be concrete when we're describing that some guy found some result in their paper, but that usually doesn't give us a hard and fast law or rule that we can apply forever in every circumstance without any risk, without anything being flawed. So more often than not, it's actually best to appreciate from the outset that we're dealing with things that can change shape depending on how we look at them and how we interpret them. And even something as simple as whether we give kids praise when we're coaching them and things. In the same room, I've had children say to me, "Oh, I really like that." And the kid next to him will say, "Oh, I don't like that. It feels like I'm being mollycoddled." So I think it's very important that we actually start to understand and accept the nuances and the exceptions rather than trying to gloss over them and find some grand unifying rule or principle. The other advice I would give to those just beginning their studies would be to accept that this is going to be a whole different way of studying once you enter university, and that we're no longer describing facts or describing historical events. Or if we are, that's usually only going to be enough to get us a pass or a low second level degree. What most of the time we're looking for to do really well at university is the ability to analyse and interpret and add value and generate some sort of insight. And these are often called being critical or offering some critique. But it's a really important point that to go for those higher marks, you have to be able to find this array of information from different studies, often with contradictory findings, and not just say, well, they differ, but actually to try and work out why they differ and what it means and whether that's useful in the real world. So what you should not do is simply offer your opinion, so write an entire essay and then say it's different and people can't agree, so I think, insert opinion. But to actually analyse and put it all together and maybe use a table or some sort of analytic technique to actually generate some insight and actually present it in a way that somebody else can follow your workings and go, yeah, you've added value beyond just going to the library and showing me what was already there. That's probably the difference between the guys who do okay and really well. And that would be the thing that I ask everybody, if I could, to think about.